everybody. Hi, I'm Ryan Hedak. For those of you who saw the last panel a half hour ago, you watched me introduce myself. I'm going to do it again. I'm a writer and performer. I was most notably in the Under the Radar Festival at the Public Theater with a piece called Hi, Are You Single? Which I wrote and performed about my experience as a gay, horny individual with cerebral palsy. And that's why Andrew Kircher asked me to moderate these panels, because he thought that I was funny and charming, and I hope that you think that too. And I'm here with Jacqueline Baggins, playwright and co-founder of Fresh Ground Pepper. I'm here with Scott Shepherd and Jennifer Kidwell of Lightning Rod Special, which is a theater, Philadelphia-based theater company, and they were most recently in a big splash in New York for the Underground Railroad game, and Jacqueline made a big splash with Men on Boats as a playwright. So we're going to talk about how they made their works, how they make work in general, and it's going to be a lot of questions from you guys. So I'm going to stop talking after a while and moderate those questions, but let's start with each of you telling us a little bit about yourselves as artists and the companies that you have formed with each other to make your own work. Okay. So let's start with Jacqueline, since you're closest to me.
Hi, my name is Jacqueline. I am a playwright, first and foremost, I would say. I've a couple of plays that have happened in New York that you might have heard of as Men on Boats, which happened last year and the year before that, and then some of my work with Theater Reconstruction Ensemble, which is a small downtown company that focuses on like reconstructing classics and new works. I also run a company called Fresh Ground Pepper, which is an incubating home for facilitating and celebrating the artistic process. We're not a producing company, we just do events and have developmental groups for people making new work. And I am also a mom, so I have a kid, which is like the fun life project for me. Yeah, I guess that's it. That's me in a little nutshell. Yeah.
Amazing.
Hey, what's up? I'm Scott Shepherd, and I'm, I guess I identify as a creator performer. Also, I love to write, but I often write on my feet, and sometimes that means that I continue to perform that role, and sometimes it means I don't. I'm a co-director of a company in Philadelphia called Lightning Rod Special. We make original devised theater performance pieces. We try to sometimes tackle Lightning Rod issues and make work that is a little bit scary, and made some other pieces with Pig Iron Theater Company, where I went to school and met Jen Kidwell, Jennifer Kidwell. Yeah, that's a good start. We'll keep digging in as we go.
My name's Jen Kidwell, and like Scott said, I went to Pig Iron School in Philly, and I live in Philly now, and I make work. I'm a company member of Lightning Rod Special and associated with Wilma Theater in Philly and a Pig Iron company member, and make things on my own and then perform in other people's things sometimes.
Amazing. Wonderful. I, as a writer and performer, am fascinated by what your company says that it's an actor-driven company, and that the work comes out of the actor. Why did you feel the need to move in that direction? Was there a absence of something that you thought was missing that led you to say, hey, I need to make space for this kind of work, or for myself to be a performer in this kind of work? This to both of you. I'm going to just ask general questions to the area between the two of you, and you guys can always like decide.
Well, no, but I should be clear. I'm going to let Scott feel the Lightning Rod Special questions, because I'm a company member, and there's a strange timeline history with the company, so I think you're
cool.
Far better.
Okay, I'll jump in. So I think I started out as a person who wanted to be a writer and a kind of sit down at a table and write, or sit down at a table and type kind of person, and I still do that and write short stories and things like that. I also had a very difficult time with that very solitary practice of writing, and I had a trouble kind of finding my way into theater. And I went to the Pig Iron School because I saw that they were making work in a different way that I knew nothing about. It was sometimes called the bias theater. So I started to learn this practice of writing on my feet. And so now the company that I'm a co-director of, we are kind of continuing in that tradition. So we believe, or you know, one of the things we talk about a lot is that theater shouldn't start with a prioritization of words, but instead it should start with space and bodies and kind of making statements, not necessarily with words. Maybe those words later on need to become emphasized for the sake of that piece, but when you start with a new project, like its genetics are unique to that project, and they might not require a playwright or a playwriting sensibility to make that particular piece of theater. So we start from that place, and then I also am obsessed with language, so oftentimes language finds its way back into the piece. And you know, we always joke about how playwrights really need more devising help, and devising people need more playwriting. And I think that's something that really is true with our company, right? That we will often make something really scrambled and exciting in the space, and then it takes a long time for the playwriting to be as smart as the like instantaneous like moment of you know, inspiration that we found someday a month ago that we're trying to recreate. So it's that long process of figuring out how things need to be structured together, so that both of those, both the like kind of raw feeling of having made something in the space matches with the, I don't know, the intelligence or the craft of the writing. So that's kind of what we are trying to do, devise theater, but then stepping in with a playwright's mind and seeing if we can't make something that is exciting in both areas.
And Jennifer, what does it feel like to be a performer in that process as a member of the company?
That's tricky too. I'll just talk about how, like, for me to be a performer who is like used to working in this way, and so it's tricky to know, like, stepping into somebody else's framework, to know what is exactly being asked of you as an artist. But I think that some people really want to take a performer up on the like many different facets of what you could bring to the table, and some people don't. Like, some people would prefer to say, like, I'd like for you to stand there and I'd like for you to do this way. And I'm a kind of person who thrives more in the former situation, and so I find there's a negotiation that needs to happen, that there are questions that I might have about the subject matter, and for me, like, research is really, really big. So I have all these questions about, you know, like, what are we doing and why are we doing it? And then there are these questions about, like, what exactly is being asked of me in this particular production, in this particular system. I think it's figuring out what it is we're all building towards is just as much a part of my process, if you will, or practice,
sure,
as it is figuring out what exactly my role is, like, not role like on the little sheet that's like so-and-so play such and such, but just like what is my role in the room, like what is being asked of me in the room. Is it solely to like say the words of somebody else or do the movement of somebody else, or is it like a little bit more dramaturgical and also like more directorial or like more writing. That's fun.
Jethan, you say you identify first and foremost as a playwright, and I see that you have a wonderful notebook here in which you've already began taking notes.
So
talk to us. Are you the type of playwright that sits behind a desk and just and types things, or are you? Tell us about your process when you're starting to think of a new piece. Where it takes you, and do you start in the notebook? Do you start on your feet? Do you start talking to your child? Like what happens?
Yeah, no, that's a great question. I was totally nodding on with both of you guys as you spoke, because I feel like. As a writer, words are my text is the language I speak. That being said, I mean that's my strongest asset in any kind of process. But I truly believe that that asset is one part of an entire ecology of what a play can be. And so it's always, I have a devising background. I used to be a performer, but writing is what my favorite thing is to do. So that's sort of where my mind lives. But I'm really drawn to processes where I can use writing as kind of a blueprint to build off of with the help and the minds of collaborators, whether they're, designers, directors, movers, actors, kind of being able to let the piece inform me via the people who I'm working with. So it's, in that way I think that playwriting is the best thing I can offer to a theatrical process. I'm a really bad dancer. I could draw some things and find a pretty costume. I'm I don't know how to do it. So, my language of actualizing the other parts of theatrical process is definitely lesser than, but so I always like to, if someone's if I can be involved in any way, I know that writing is probably the way for me to contribute the most.
And yet you also did co-found the organization, which is no small thing. You know what I mean? So what was that impetus? Why Fresh Ground Pepper, and what is it like to be on the administrative side as well?
The way that Fresh Ground Pepper started was it was definitely born out of coming out of my schooling, which was at NYU. I did undergrad at Playwrights Horizons Theater School, and I in that program we were taught a lot about how to be a good collaborator. That's sort of the main thing I took out of that schooling. And we started Fresh Ground Pepper because we realized there was not a good place that we could find to be able to share with each other the processes of work that we were doing in a way that didn't feel incredibly encumbered by financial needs or the financial burden of a production, or B, the pressure that comes with showcasing work that isn't ready for something, mm-hmm. For feedback that isn't delighted, so it's all about you in those early days it was a lot of open mic style presentation, but we've been doing it for about 9 years now, and we have over the course of those 9 years we've been able to sort of listen to artists we know who are I would love an opportunity to work in this way. And we, as a facilitating company, tries to honor that or fulfill that need in some way. We now have a retreat that we run every summer that lasts for about a month. We bring in new artists every week. We do a writers group that's not just for playwrights and directors; it's also for we've had novelists in the group. We had short story writers. So it's a nice set of deadlines and checkpoints for writers. We have a devising group, a producer's lab, and we're going to be premiering a festival, our first ever festival next spring, which is a showcase of a culmination of all of that work, but all centered around the idea of work in process and what it means to bring together a group of people to delight in and celebrate, a work that will go on to larger life. Give it a nice sort of send off as those artists can continue to make their work and continue to hone in and refine. And what, I mean, the biggest joy for me in doing it, even though I used to use Fresh Ground Pepper, you know, the opportunities we provided for my own artistry, and I don't do that as much anymore. But the biggest, it's always such a gift for me to be able to, like, engage with other artists who are working, be inspired by them, and to, like, it sort of, it keeps you, I don't know, engaged in the artistic world, even if you're kind of like if I'm having a bad day about my own ideas, and I'm like, ugh, well, you know, at least I can, like, sit in the room with someone else's good ideas and, like, and, you know, chew on them for a while and be inspired. And so it's a good way for me to re-engage in, like, how hard it is to create work and to be able to, I don't know, it feels like a nice way to give to the community of art makers in the city.
Wonderful. Yeah. Now let's talk about your two major pieces, the two most recent major pieces that you've done individually, starting with Men on Boats. For those who didn't see it, we're going to just assume that nobody saw it, you know, some of you probably did. Just a little snippet of that piece and what it means to you and what it is about.
Yeah, Men on Boats. So I started writing that play in, like, 2013. It is a play that I was really hungry to write something that had, like, a really large physical vocabulary on stage, something that felt very adventurous and felt very, you know, like, was based in survival tactics. I wasn't sure what the story was gonna be yet. I was just like, oh, good. Like, I write a bunch of, like, people who are, like, starving, like, fighting for their lives, but, like, in an adventure way, not in, like, a, you know, like, the stakes were sort of on their own terms kind of way. And so I stumbled upon the journals of John Wesley Powell, who ran an expedition to run and chart the Colorado River and the Green River and the Grand Canyon, eventually, as we know it now, in 1869. And so, and I had known about him since I was a kid. He's a, like, sort of an Arizona folk hero in a way, or folk, maybe not hero, just a guy. A folk guy. one of those guys on boats, yeah. So I read his journals and I was like, oh yeah, this guy, like, reading his journals, the characters are so, they just jumped off the page. It was such, like, a ragtag ensemble of people. So I started writing a play. I was like, this honestly would be a great sort of true source adaptation, a great adventure piece. I will have so much fun writing it. And then as I started to write it, I got a little bit into the why I was writing. Like, what is getting me about? Like, why is this so fun for me to write? What is propelling me, keeping me writing this piece? And it had something to do with the fact that it was the kind of role that someone like me would never get to play, and that someone like, you know, like my ability to inhabit this sort of rugged explorer is pretty limited in the mindset of, like, you know, naturalism or
society.
You know, society, reality, society especially at that time, you know? So I just sort of was like, well, let's see what happens if that's just not true. And then around that time I started working with Will Davis, the director, who eventually went on to direct the piece. And we were able to sort of unpack that idea further, and that kind of made its way into the revisions of the piece. And what ended up happening was we had a really amazing cast of, you know, female-identifying, trans-identifying, gender non-conforming actors across a wide spectrum of performative styles. And everyone, you know, it was like they all played these historical figures, and it was, we all had a blast doing it. And yeah, it was fun. It happened last year. Last year it happened at Playwrights Horizons, but it was a co-production with Club Femme, who had initially produced it. Oh, cool. In Summerworks. But yeah.
Okay, now let's move on to Underground Railroad Game. Tell us about that. I listened to you on WNYC, and you said that the collaboration began with, like, a very late night conversation that just happened out of nowhere that made Jen just laugh so hard about a game that you played in middle school. But, like, once you had that, like, once you did that in, you know, that night together, oh, how hysterical is this? when did you realize, okay, let's make something bigger out of a game that I played when I was a child?
You go.
So we had that conversation, but but we also, so we were in school together and we got assigned to create a dance. And I wasn't able to carry out the assignment. And so I asked Scott if he wouldn't mind doing makeup work to fulfill this assignment, because our dance teacher was like really disappointed. She was like, oh, you guys are the only duet I'm making. And like at the time we hadn't worked together very much and everybody was kind of mystified about what she thought she saw. She's like, I just see so much when you guys are working together. And I was just like, what are you seeing? We were like working in two very different vocabularies. But she was like, you're not gonna be there, that's really too bad. And I was like, oh, I'll bet Scott will help me make it up, Nicole. And so we tried to make this dance, choreograph this dance, and it was really bad. I mean, it was...
Yeah.
I feel like it gets worse every time you tell this story, though.
It was bad. It was really bad. It was not good.
To each other.
We're going to be doing a dance component at the end of this.
I know, but I was like, wouldn't it be cool if, like, we were in the background doing some, like, abstract movement? Like, I'm trying to keep this conversation in my body, too. So we tried to make this dance, and that didn't work out, and then Scott had this plan to make a one-person show about this thing that he had done in middle school, and as we were failing at the choreography, he suggested that we try to succeed at theater. So, it was true, you were like, this is going so well, but perhaps we should try to make a show out of this thing that, and I was like, yeah, I did find that very crazy. So then we started, we applied to a program at what is now Fringe Arts in Philly, that's what was called Jumpstart, and we got into Jumpstart, and there was like a 15-minute piece, and then we did a lot of research, and I think it was really research that kind of led to the seed of the piece, like the sort of core of the piece, going to see a talk about the Underground Railroad in Philly at a federally funded site, history site, where the gentleman who was talking about the Underground Railroad did not know how to describe enslaved people. Stumbling over African-American slave. So that became like the core of the piece. And then we had this 15-minute thing and that like felt good. We were still interested in the material. And then we grew that out through like a lot of play and improvisation and like working with Sarah Sanford, who was our teacher and also went on to direct the first iteration. So then we took it to New Orleans. We met Brad, who saw the piece there in like a 47-minute version, something like that. And then like then we applied to like NACL and got had a residency there and developed it there. And
what can you tell us if that is just for those who don't know NACL?
National, whoa.
It's like
soft. It is like soft, but there's North American Cultural Laboratory.
Thank you.
That's bad that I did. But it's, they have a residency called Deep Space, and it's an opportunity to like continue to like work on material, and so we did that, and we...
Amfest.
And like each iteration of the work, it was kind of like it was a snowball effect, and we were learning more about the piece. I mean, this is something that's really important to me, like making work, is that, like generally speaking, like the first iteration of anything that I might present you is probably gonna not be very good. And I think it's important to put something in front of people to learn reflectively. Like, it's not so much about people's opinions, like, I don't like what you're doing, or I don't think that this is a, like, why are you asking these questions? But it's more like, what did that do to you to sit and watch that happen? And in conversation, to me, like that's as much a part of research as like going to see a talk or reading a book or reading a magazine article. So being able to put work up in front of people and have conversation around it and to grow the community around, like Brad's a part of the community of Underground Railroad Game, is like really what allowed it to breathe and grow.
And we're like, and that piece is a lot of clown, you know, I mean, and that is because there's so much direct address and just reacting to the way that people will, like, I don't know, they're in the room, so you have to figure out all these amazing ways to incorporate them for that piece, you know.
So now, I mean, what happened to you guys artistically with these pieces is like a dream for any artist. They start, you know, at a fringe festival, and then they go to AnFest, and then they get a major run at Ars Nova, or you start at the summer series at Club Fountain, and then you suddenly write Playwright Horizons. So I'm going to ask you all, I mean, it's basically the same question. How do you go from an incubation series like that, or sort of a lower risk situation, and then entice presenters or producers to say, hey, I think this could go even further, to make it, make that leap and then get the wider audience that obviously these pieces both deserve?
I guess I'll talk, because I didn't talk last time. Okay. I mean, it's a lot of luck, and it's a lot of, like, working on the piece really hard and making it as exciting as possible. I mean, you know, Ars Nova, who eventually ended up producing the final version of this show and gave us a lot of resources to do a dream design on the piece and continue working on some of the parts that were continuing to elude us. I mean, the first time we talked to him about it, we were like, so what if Ars Nova produced Underground Railroad game? And they were like, no. And we're like, okay, great. And that's how it was for like a year and a half. And then we did, you know, we just kept working on the show.
And would you just invite them to presentations? Or
yeah, we invited them to presentations.
We stayed in touch in a lot of ways. Like, I met Andrew because they were like, will you do this workshop? And, like, I was in their building doing the workshop. And I was like, yeah, so I'm also, like, doing these things.
Still have that show. Still have that show.
I think, and, like, in working on it, I think, like, it's not just that we were rehearsing, but we were rehearsing in order to put it in front of people and to talk about it and put it in front, like, inviting people, like presenters, to say, like, hey, this is where we are with this thing. We still have a lot of questions, but perhaps you see some potential. And being ready and, like, hearing a lot of times, like, no, like, not, we're not the people for that. Like, we're not interested in that. And at this point, like, you know, after that run and, like, being able to work with somebody like Tommy to produce a tour, like, still getting, like, notes from people. I mean, I think the thing that I am really able to do in a situation like this is just hear no and just, like, not let it deter me. Just, like, that's your no. I'm going to keep working on this over here. Because you get told that as often as you get told yes. And, like, if you really want to do it, then you just do it. Can't wait for somebody to tell you yes.
I mean, literally the major presentation at the Fringe, they first said no.
Yeah, everybody said
Everybody said no before they said yes. Brad did not say no. Let it be known on the record.
That's, I mean, I'm sitting here, like, hearing no all the time, and yeah. As an artist myself, and it's like, well, how do you, I guess, then when a place, if you know in your, hey, I want Ars Nova to produce this, and they say no, how do you know not to move on, or move, or to go, try to go elsewhere?
Well, I guess we should also say that their no was like, we don't want to produce your show, right? We don't think we're right to produce your show, but we're going to put you in conversation with people who we think are right. And so that's like, no, it's not right for us, but we see merit in this. We believe in you. Like, we want to stay in conversation. And I think that the ability to continue a relationship like that allows our, like, we're growing at the same time as the relationship is growing, right? That the work is growing at the same time. So hearing a yes in some respect, I think, is important, and staying diligent about, like, what it is we're after. Like, and knowing, like, we knew that the piece wasn't done. I mean, you know, I'll probably tell you over a glass of whiskey, like, I still don't think it's done. But, you know, like, we know, like, we're still, like, digging and working and working, and that what we're asking people to believe in is not something that's finished or something like, we're not gonna say like, you're gonna be able to sell everything out. This is gonna be a hit. Everybody's gonna like it. Everybody's gonna like you. These are not things that we can say. What we can say is like, we continue to be interested in this and like, we hope that there's a way that you are too. How are you interested in it? If it's not the work for your stage, then like, is it an incubation opportunity like in your summertime? Like, can we ask you for rehearsal space? Which actually is, I feel like asking institutions for rehearsal space is tantamount to asking business people for informational interviews, in which you're like, I would like to go in and talk to you about what it is that you do, and like, I'm gonna engage with you, you're gonna meet me, and like, I think you're gonna fall in love with me, but I'm also here under the auspices of carrying out my own mission, which is to let you know that I have one, and I'm busy with this thing. But we got a lot of free rehearsal space from Fringe Arts when they had said that they didn't want to do our piece. And we also would ask Ars Nova for rehearsal space, and it's like, we're here working, you hear us having a great time, and like, we're working really hard on this thing, or would you mind stopping in and seeing what we're up to?
And
just staying at it.
Yeah. And part of it is like, Ars Nova's mission is to incubate and launch, develop and launch new artists, right? And so part of it was, it wasn't that they were like, we don't believe in the show, like clearly they did. They actually were, they're like, we'll incubate the next thing you do, and we're gonna advocate for the show to go to XYZ. And when XYZ said no, they were like, fuck it, let's just do it ourselves. I mean, that's kind of what, I mean, Jason Egan always believed in the show and believed in us making it. It was just a matter of like, well, it already has had this life, so maybe I should make the next thing. I mean, yeah, I don't know what he would say if he were here in this room, but that's kind of the narrative, is like, we couldn't get it to any of these other places. And then he was just like, I'm gonna do it.
And I think too, we had done, like, so we kept at Fringe Arts in Philly, and then we finally they said to our faces, we are taking a huge chance on you by producing your show in our festival. We're gonna take this chance. And so they did, and then that went well. And so then they were like, hey, we'd like for you to come back and do it again. And in that period of time, we worked on it some more. Like, there were shifts in the team and the community around the piece, but we were still working. And so it was different when we did it in the spring. And then we invited Ars Nova to come down and see
how they
saw both, and they saw that we had continued working on it. And they're like, okay, we're gonna take a chance on you and like put you in our season. All of this knowing that it was still in motion, like things weren't delayed, with huge questions about the piece that weren't answered, and like everybody was taking huge leaps of faith.
Yeah.
Us included.
And Jacqueline, what did you know? Oh, I wanted to be in a proscenium. I wanted to be at Playwrights Horizons. Or did you just like, was that a mission of yours to go bigger, or did it just sort of happen that way?
It's funny. It wasn't a mission when I was initially writing the piece, but I started writing the piece actually in Club Thumb's early career writers group, which I didn't know Club Thumb. I didn't know Maria very well until like a month beforehand. I met her. She actually had read a piece of mine and didn't really like that piece. She was like, I don't think this piece is right for us, but the writer seems intriguing. So I like walked with her and her dog Otto, like while she did errands in the East Village, and we had a meeting in the streets. And she, you know, we talked about like writing process and stuff. And then she was like, she emailed me like a month later and was like, I'm putting together this writers group. We've never done it before. It's all early career writers. And so I was like, totally. I've never been able to do one of these before. Like, I run a group like this, but I've never been in one. So I was like, yeah. And so I started writing Men on Boats in that group. And my Club Thumb also does, they do this super lab, which is like a 29-hour workshop, essentially, for a new play that is partnered with Playwrights Horizons. So they invited me to do one. It was her and Adam Greenfield at Playwrights. And so that was the first time when I was like, oh, like, Club Thumb, who I think clearly, like, they have shown interest in this piece, they are, like, part of the reason I, like, that this piece exists, you know. they could produce it, but they also, I didn't realize the connection between the two companies until I heard about that. And then at that point I was sort of like, oh, I think that this play could have a life, you know. At that point I was like, they hadn't even asked me to do a production yet, but I was starting to think in that manner. Because the play as it stands on the page is, it's intriguing, but it's sort of, there's a lot of blanks to be filled in that are filled in with like the movement vocabulary existing in the play, the design questions in the play. Like it sort of is begging to be produced. And so in my mind, at least, I don't know who's on the other side, like, well, I'm begging to do it too. Like, I don't know if that exists. But in my mind, I was like, oh, I think this play could do really well in like a sort of small scenario like Summer Works. And I think it could also probably like fill out a proscenium stage. So I was, at that point, I could see the possibility for it. And I didn't, you know, I didn't want to like count on anything because like that it seemed like almost too good to be true that people were having such a good time making it. And so I was just sort of like, well, I'm just gonna like hope that that's what happens. And then that's what it did. But it really took, you know, like playwrights, you know, at the Super Lab, at the final reading of the piece where like the staff of playwrights and the staff of Club Thumb is both present, like it was very clear, you know, and like friends and family and stuff, it was very clear that they were all like super pumped by the show. So at that point, I knew I had a ton of work to do. And so I was like, if I do the work that I know I need to, if I make sure that my, you know, the collaborative team is like pushing me to answer big questions, then like it could have a long life. So yeah, it was like, I didn't think it would happen until it was happening.
But then you did it at Club Thumb. Mm-hmm. Summer Works, and then there was a gap of time.
Yeah.
And in that gap of time, are you knocking on the doors and saying, hey, do you want to do this? Or did they just organically come to you and say, I'm interested?
They sort of told me that they kind of made it clear that they wanted that to be the thing. I think that at that time, too, Club Thumb and Playwrights formalized a partnership between their two companies. So Playwrights has, they have that sort of resident company program. Club Thumb was named their first resident company like the same year that all of this happened. So they were like, what a great way to showcase. It was sort of like an opportunity for them to showcase the partnership in a way that was like, it was very much luck in timing in that way. But yeah, like they were like, well, I also was like, I found out I was pregnant around that same time. So I was like, if you guys want to do this, great. I'm like, I need to peace out for a second and like, so you guys have to figure out if it's happening or not. And so and then they were like, yeah, totally. So that was, I'm glad they did that work on their own, because I was not present to be able to take part in some of those conversations.
That's true. Okay, we're gonna open it up to questions now. And Jose is gonna run around with the microphone. So if you have a question, raise your hand. All the way in the back.
It's really interesting to hear all this. My question is, when and how did you know how to make it happen? And I'm asking this through the lens of, you know, we look around the room and where are the college kids that need to know this? You know, you need to know that it's about who you know and knowing who to know and knowing how to approach them and knowing that you can approach them and knowing what to say when you get to be on the dog walk with them. So it's interesting to me, especially for the live stream, to know when you knew how to make this happen. Like, when did you go, oh, I can just email the people at Ars Nova and expect that they will even engage me as a person? You know, that kind of thing.
I think for me, it was when I decided that I decided to quit my like really horrible day job that was kind of sucking my soul out, and I knew that I had to like fulfill my life with side jobs and little sort of piecemeal gigs, and I was like I can either go into the foray of like finding a full-time job that that really fulfills me, or I can like really run hard at freelancing and just make that my path. So I was like managing a really dumpy bar in the East Village, and I kept getting yelled at because like drunk men were trying to like steal things, and they were like, "That's your problem." And I was like, "These are horrible drunk people." And so I was like, "I guess I'm not cut out for the bar life." So I quit, but it was around then that I decided that I was able to sort of unburden myself from a particular kind of stresses and then engage in like the stress of creating work, and that shift in focus was really big for me, and it kind of allowed me to reprioritize my art and then subsequently like prioritize the scary conversations, because I think that I wouldn't have had anything to say to them I wouldn't have had anything to contribute to the conversation if I wasn't, the work wasn't my priority. And so yeah, I was definitely eating ramen for a solid amount of time. But but yeah, that was my turning point, I think.
I made work for many years and no one paid attention. I think that was actually really good for me. And I was in Philadelphia, which isn't even where I feel like you can fail gloriously in early stages of your career, which I did. And after a while, there was a piece that I made collaboratively with some people that I was going to school with that kind of hit the scene and had more buzz about it. And then so people started to take a little bit of notice, but you know, the artistic director of Fringe Arts, which is like the leading presenter of experimental work in Philadelphia, arguably, did not go to see that show, but probably started to hear about it. And then the next year, started to collaborate with people who were a little bit more well-known because they had started to notice and were more interested in our work, so collaborated with people who carried a little bit more weight artistically and from a producerial point of view, just drew more attention. And that kind of had a little mini buzz around it too. And so gradually, there was finally, when we were making Underground Railroad Game, we were at a place where we still put on a piece in a church for more money than we should have, just for two people to see it. After we had made it and taken it and worked on it for a year and a half, we put up produced our own like presented version of the show for two people to see it. And finally, they saw it. And then they said no. And then they finally were convinced that they could maybe start to say yes. We had a meeting with them where we kind of, I mean, I remember being like, please? I remember him being like, I don't know, it's just like kind of vignettes. It's just like these vignettes. I just wish. And I was like, well, we've done everything on our own, and maybe if you help support us, we can make it better. And then finally, it just, you know, then we could communicate with them. And then we got it into AntFest. And once we got into AntFest, Jason Egan introduced himself to us that night. And wanted to have a meeting, you know, in like a year of just meetings where we were talking about things before finally a conversation about the production at Ars Nova kind of officially happened. That's kind of a long-winded answer to your question, but for the person in Philadelphia who kind of finally put this show on the map a little bit, it was years of doing work that he only heard about, you know, peripherally, until finally we could convince him by kind of collaborating up and getting a show that people were really even more excited about. Finally, we were able to get him in the room by self-presenting our show just for him, really. And then we invited the rest of everybody to come for free so we could pack the house. And then things started to kind of snowball. But we always, you know, we never like emailed Jason Egan out of the blue. Like we did AmpFest or we did some other platform. And then through the work, got to know those people. And then we were able to kind of calibrate what kinds of emails or kinds of asks we could make and oftentimes we were figuring that out on the fly.
I think just to like tie both these things in and to say directly to like college students is like all of these things have to do with applying for people who want to put on emerging work. Like Jumpstart is for emerging work, Deep Space is to incubate work, AntFest is for new work, and all, none of these things have like a gatekeeper of you need to know somebody. It's like we're trying to find and help new things. So to not be afraid of applying for things and to apply for everything, and
first
also
grad
know that you
that's
might get
first grad
numbers.
Numbers.
That's what you're doing.
It's your incubating, facilitating organization.
Yeah, Fresh Ground Pepper, we do that. It's like a, it's we actually work with a lot of like just out of college artists and people who are just starting because there's a low pressure at the beginning, especially when it's something like engaging in prompts or something that is like all about trying to uncover like really new ideas. Like you don't have to be, you'll be a very seasoned artist and have like a baby idea that sounds really shitty, you know? So like, but yeah, it's like a, it's a good place to feel safe in your art making. But yeah, it's, yeah, jumping in, yeah, like applying for those things is, yeah, I agree. It's like super, it's, that's, I applied for so many things and I've got so many no's forever. Like I still do that. I still apply and get no's. You know, some yeses, which is great, but you know. That's the life.
Okay. I feel bad because only one person got to ask a question. But we talked for a really long time. And I think we got some really valuable information out of these wonderful folks. So thank you to Jennifer and Scott and Jacqueline for engaging with us today. And thank you to all of you for listening. And I hope that you learned something because I certainly did. I'm gonna go home and write in my journal.
Okay.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Thank you all so, so much. We have another new dramaturgy presentation right now at 5. If you want to hang in the house while we set up for that, by all means. Hi, I'm Jose.